watching us online. And this is a topic about sustainable fashion. So officially the name of the topic is Empowers New Clothes. And of course, I think many people who are joining this session are already the converted crowd. You already heard about sustainable fashion. You already heard about a fast fashion. We also know that there is a lot of waste that's being created. We know that every single second there is an equivalent of a truck that's being either burned or disposed on a landfill. So this is a huge waste of the resources. But it's not only waste of resources, it's actually a huge waste of financials as well. According to Ellen MacArthur Foundation, it's actually annually $400 billion that we are just throwing away. And throwing something away sounds like it magically disappears, but we know very well that's not really the case. And while maybe those last years talking sustainable fashion was considered alternative for some people, we're seeing every single day that more and more people are joining, really rethinking what we can do better. And I'm very excited to have here two amazing ladies who are going to be talking about new materials, circular economy, what we can do, what's the future of the fashion, and also how all of us in the room, but also online, can become the change makers. So my name is Andrea Orsag. I'm a co-founder of MissionC. Super excited to be part of this session because clothes all of us are wearing, typically, I would guess, I would hope. And without further ado, I'd like to give a word to Nicole Rawling. She's actually, just a little introduction, the CEO and co-founder of Material Innovation Institute, Innovation and Material Innovation Initiative. But she's really very interested also in animal products and how we can phase them out, how we can replace them with the plant-based alternative. So within company and institute Good Food, she's been exploring how with a multi-stakeholder engagement, including entrepreneurs, including scientists, companies, governmental bodies, we can really make the change happen, and not only on a small scale, but how we can really make it mainstream. So right now she's deep diving into the new gen materials. She's very sought after speaker and had a chance to speak on stages and highly regarded meetings from Brazil, India, all over European Union and United States. And we're super excited to have her today with us in Berlin. Nicole, please.
Thank you so much. So I'm actually the only person I've met today from the United States. I don't know if I win for using up the most CO2 flying here. So it's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you all for your interest in new materials. So this is me. Thank you, so I don't have to introduce myself again. And this is our organization. So if we look at the fashion industry and we want to make it more sustainable, what's the most important thing for us to do? We believe that it's actually focusing on raw materials because 66 to 80% of a brand's total environmental footprint comes from raw materials. If we want to figure out now which raw materials should we focus on, if you look at global warming, eutrophication, water scarcity, abiotic resource depletion, for all of those, 4 out of the top 5 of the worst materials for the environment come from animal-based sources. So now if we really care about all of those issues, it makes a lot of sense to focus on animal-based material. Now, polyester makes up the vast majority of the products on the market. The nice thing is that the technology that we're working on and helping develop can actually affect those areas like polyester and nylon as well. So consumers are also becoming more and more concerned about animal welfare. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to show you any videos of what goes on behind the scenes. Even I don't like seeing those. But there really is no way to take a body part of an animal without causing cruelty. And undercover investigations show over and over the inherent cruelty in animal agriculture, even in certified farms. And so we really do need to move away from animal-based materials as well. But is there something better? There actually is. So if you look at cow leather, compared to other materials. Cow leather contributes 4 times more greenhouse gas emissions than synthetic leather. Think pleather, things that are on the market right now, and 6 times more greenhouse gas emissions than plant-based leather. So this industry is very nascent. There's a lot of companies who are conducting life cycle analyses, new environmental impact assessments, and we're seeing even better numbers. And so we're going to see a huge environmental impact reduction with these new materials. So this is our organization, the Material Innovation Initiative. We are a nonprofit. We are working on fast-tracking innovation in the fashion, automotive, and home goods industries in leather, wool, silk, down, fur, and exotic skins. We describe ourselves as a think and do tank, which means that we're out analyzing the entire industry, looking at where there's white space opportunities and where we can affect change. And then we go in and we work with scientists to develop new research. We work with entrepreneurs to create new companies. We work with investors to fund those companies. And then we work with brands to help them understand the market, the predictions of what's to come, and help matching them up with the new innovators. So last year and the year before, we did a consumer research study. I'm not going to go through all of this because I only have 5 minutes, but I do want to point out 2 really interesting statistics. 55% of consumers in the U.S. would prefer purchasing a leather alternative to leather right now. This is across the entire United States. It was even higher in China with 66%. Now, if you look at lab-grown leather, and yes, there is such a thing. You're taking actual animal cells and growing it in a lab. 76% of U.S. consumers would prefer it, and 80% of Chinese. We're also seeing a lot of interest from brands. So I don't know if you're all in the fashion industry, and you saw Gucci's announcement yesterday. They've started to develop their own plant-based leather. I know Kering's involved, or Kering's in the space, so's Hermes, Nike, Adidas, Stella McCartney. I could take up my 5 minutes talking about all the brands in the space. So there's consumer demand, there's brand demand. So why are we not seeing more in the market? It's actually because the alternatives right now don't meet these 4 qualities. We don't want the market to sacrifice. We want you to have the right products that meet your needs, the high quality, reasonable price, at scale, and are sustainable. And so this is what we're working with the entire industry to make sure that the new products meet these. So today, it wasn't meant to be today, but today we are actually putting out the first next-gen state of the industry report. So it's going to be up on our website soon. Hopefully it'll be in the media soon. But this is one of the charts from that report where we've analyzed all of the companies in the space, all of the investments in the space. There's only 74 companies across all 6 categories. That's tiny for an entire industry. And so what we need is we need more competition in the space. That's the way the marketplace works. The more competition, the better the quality, the lower the price, and the more sustainable. So we just want more companies to be in this space. So I'm not going to go through this in detail because you can actually get this and an entire report on mycelium technology on our website, but I wanted to show you how this process works. So when we're talking about these next-gen materials, there's about 5 different types of technology that's used to create them. This is just one. It's a mycelium process where you actually mix agricultural waste with fungal spores to create a leather. And this is the one that Stella McCartney is using, and this is the one that Hermes is using. And finally, I want to end with the huge potential in this space. The animal material market, and this is just materials, this is not end goods, is $129 billion. The alternatives are less than 1% of that right now. So if you're an investor, if you're an entrepreneur, this is a huge market. We do believe that the next gen materials are going to take over. I am actually from the food industry and helped develop the entire plant-based food industry, and we're seeing huge takeovers from plant-based foods at the moment, and we think the same thing's going to happen. So thank you all so much.
Thank you very much, Nicole. So indeed, congratulations on the Next Gen Materials Report. Yay. Super excited to see it online later today.
Hopefully it's coming out. It was supposed to be out yesterday.
Way to go. Thank you so much. And we have with us today also Lavinia Muth. Lavinia is a head of corporate responsibility at a beloved brand, Armedangels, based here in Germany, but they're selling in quite some destinations. And Lavinia is definitely a social and environmental activist. And before joining Armedangels, which happened 4 years ago, right?
Exactly.
She's been really deep diving and exploring child labor in a global trade. And she got a chance to dive as someone doing audits, but also consulting producers, manufacturers, and brands in countries like India, China, South America, Turkey, European Union. And she's been helping all those different companies and organizations with how to take on the textile industry standards and how to become better, especially with a focus on transparency and chemical industry. So, while she really enjoys working in a Florida factory, she's also a huge fan of exploring strategic innovation. Very curious to hear, Lavinia, what you're going to share with us today. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. How does this work? Oh yeah, here we go. So again, my name is Lavinia. I'm from Armedangels. For the ones who don't know Armedangels, we are a German eco and fair fashion brand on the market since 14 years now. Yeah, we started in 2007, and we started with fair trade certified organic cotton t-shirts from India. And now 14 years later, we are not only doing jersey, we are not only doing t-shirts, we are doing denim, we are doing knits, we are doing woven, we are doing underwear, we are doing everything which is supposed to be called urban fashion. I do believe we have been doing our homework since day one. That means in our product portfolio, we have 100% products without compromise, 100% materials, sustainable and regenerative materials, and 100% monitored supply chains. But as the world is changing and moving, and the industry is moving, also we as a clothing brand, whose DNA is sustainability, we have reached a point where we are realizing, although for us, sustainable biosynthetic materials have always been the new black, we have reached a point where we do believe that sustainability is not enough anymore. It's not enough anymore to work and calculate with the resources we have on our planet as if there would only be a tomorrow. So we believe that we have to think about new and regenerative systems. And basically, our new strategic goal is the so-called circular economy, right? So there's people who call it the circular economy, there's people who call it regenerative and more intelligent systems. There's people who call it zero waste production and so on and so forth. But the main point is that we have to start disrupting the linear production system. So, it's working. Very good. So, what have we been doing to kind of close the loop as a small and medium-sized fashion brand? First of all, for us, and I think for each and every one, it's very important to be aware of the fact that it's not enough to only offer solutions for the end consumer when it comes to like reusable packaging or other resale models and so on and so forth. So if we truthfully talk about a circular economy, we do not only have to start upstream, but also downstream. And this starts with the precious raw materials we are extracting or eventually recycling. So at Armedangels, we have already started, I think it's now 7 years ago, with a so-called no deadstock, no landfill policy, because this is also one of the many points nobody's talking about. You know, our whole business model is actually built on overproduction and deadstock. Deadstock is the so-called unsold inventory, and we have already partnered up several years ago with an NGO from Germany, where we are donating the tiny amount of dead stock which is still left. Then we have started, I think 2 years ago, to collect all our cutting waste and all our spinning waste and all our denim cutting waste in our production chains. We are collecting it, and we have implemented so-called reverse supply chains. So the cutting waste is recycled and then processed into a new yarn, and it ends up in our products. Then we have implemented a take-back system to offer a solution for the end consumer. So when you guys cannot wear your Armedangels t-shirt anymore, we are happy to take it back and bring it back in the loop. And and then I think as a last step, we have implemented so-called repair services, like videos, there's repair kits, and so on and so forth. This is only the start, you know, and I think we're doing a pretty good job because, like, somehow we are demonstrating and showing off that even as a small and medium-sized brand, you can actually do this, you know, because the big challenge for the small and medium-sized companies is that, in general, it's not scalable, you know. Working in a corporation and producing volumes and tons of garments and actually producing a lot of trash, it's easy to set, well, it's not easy, it's anyways a challenge, but it's easier to implement so-called take-back systems and reach the volumes to actually recycle it or resell it and reuse it and so on and so forth. So, that's almost already it. I would like to invite you in the later discussion to reinvent the wheel together. So, I think we really have to start acting together. We really have to start collaborating together to build an industry, to build a world where not only the materials we use, that's what, you know, everybody's talking about in the circular economy in general, but also water, energy, chemicals in the downstream supply chain are regenerated and recycled. Ah, yeah, and to bring back the value into the chain, because at the end of the day, it's still precious human beings creating our clothing. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. Thank you, ladies, very much. And indeed, I love that we're having this take on this whole topic of sustainable fashion from Nudie materials, as represented by Nicole. And then you, Lavinia, talking about commercial brand that's really making waters on the market. And it's great to see that there is actually so much happening. So real change makers. And right now, we are also going to dive into a discussion. And for the discussion, of course, I'm a very curious person myself, so I have lots of questions. But if any of you do have questions that are relevant for our speakers, just raise your hand. And for all of you online, just send us on a slide of the question, and we will have a look which ones to pick up. So I'm going to join you here on stage now. And yeah, talking about Nudie materials, love that indeed your whole work, Nicole, is around taking animals completely out of the supply chains, whether we're talking food, whether we're talking fashion. What do you think is needed to scale it up a little bit more? Because we still see quite a lot of people using the natural materials, and as you said, many of them are coming from animal production. How do you see it?
So our hope is to take the responsibility off the consumer. So I think everyone has different views, but I'm a single mom. I'm also just started my own company, and I have kids learning at home in a pandemic, and I think all of us have not enough information on what to buy, where can you put the most money, and especially when you're running and you're doing errands, you just pick up whatever you need, and not sustainability can't always be a part of that. And so our hope is that we can really work with the industry and the brands to ensure that the products that get to consumers are more sustainable. And we do see that happening. We've talked to 38 out of 40 top international fashion and automotive brands. 38 out of 40 are actively looking for these new materials. The other two are in fast fashion. You know, to be honest, it's not their priority. So I think it's going to happen. But I think we need to put the pressure on the brands. And like I mentioned, we just need more innovators in the space. There's actually a lot of investment money, just not a lot of great investment.
A future screen, looking forward. And Lavinia, just from a little bit different shore of fashion, because your brand, Armedangels, you're already on the market, you're talking to consumers, you're creating campaigns, disruptive campaigns, really out there engaging consumers. How do you make sure that people actually know what they're buying? So Nicole mentioned that it's difficult for consumers to identify what is actually the right t-shirt or the right dress to choose. How do you take care of that within Armedangels?
I think at Armedangels we are in a pretty luxurious situation because we've been starting with an organic cotton supply chain, which is 100% traceable and transparent. And that's also our strategy when it comes to each and every material. So I think in the last 14 years we have built up pretty much trust when it comes to the communication of the end consumer. And this is our top priority always. You know, our belief is that the magic lies in the supply chain and knowing where your material comes from, what social and environmental impact the whole production process has. I think we're doing a good communication on that, but I think also that end consumers get more sensitive. I do realize this because, you know, I'm cooperating and working a lot with our customer happiness team, and like each and every day they're coming like more and deep dive critical questions. The challenge for us being a small and medium-sized brand is, first of all, like building up the transparent and traceable supply chain because we have very small order volumes, you know, and if we nominate a raw material, this is a big challenge. And that's also the challenge when it comes to uptaking eventual new innovative materials. You know, the scalability of the materials, being a small and medium-sized company, and then also receiving detailed inside information. A lot of US American brands are coming up with like whatever CO2 neutral, carbon neutral fibers and blah, 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 blah. But transparency is not given, you know, everybody's still talking about like business secrets and they are not like disclosing input chemical streams and so on and so forth. So this is actually my big challenge when it comes to new materials, that there's no transparency. So yeah, it's I'm trying to, like, we have a risk assessment when it comes to like selecting new materials, but yeah, this is really funny. The new innovative ones, it's really, really hard for a small and medium-sized company to uptake it. Yeah, so this is like a cry out to the innovators, like be transparent and try to, you know, take us all up together.
Can I jump on in?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Oh. I 100% agree. And that's it's so good to have you say that from a brand perspective, too. Because when we work a lot with all of these innovators, so that 74 that I mentioned, we're working with them. And our solution, and you can tell me if you think this would help, we're hiring an environmental data scientist.
Perfect, yeah.
To actually go in to establish, we're putting brands together with the material companies, establishing what are we going to look for, right? Because we have to all agree on what methodology and what we're going to collect. And then have a system that we as a neutral third party can come in, collect all the data. The brands and everyone else doesn't see that proprietary process, but we can then put together the data and have it comparable by company.
Yeah, that's what we need.
Yeah, because right now you have one company might have LCA data, but can you compare it to somebody else? You don't know. Did they use similar processes? Sustainability is hard. Like, there needs
and it's
more data.
So complex.
It's super complex.
So necessary.
I do have good news, though. So we got one more speaker who's able to join us online all the way from Sweden. We got Sandya Lang, who is the sustainability manager of Nudie Jeans, brand that is really a front runner when it comes to sustainability and circular economy. And well, Sandya has been working for Nudie Jeans for a decade now. And she has also experience working with producers in Vietnam, Sri Lanka. And environment, transparency, and living wages is really what gets her heart pumping. So, Lavinia is here in person, so is Nicole. But with Sandya, we would like to say hi all the way to Sweden to you. And please tell us a little bit more about Nudie Jeans and transparency.
Hey, everyone. Thank you so much for having me, even though I cannot be there in person. So I guess many of you have heard about Nudie Jeans before.
But maybe not so many know so much about
where we are located in the world. So I just wanted to give you this brief world map where we are located. We have repair shops globally. We have also repair partners globally. And our production locations is here as well. And one detail about Nudigils is that we have three owners. It's a privately owned company. We don't have any external shareholders or investors. So basically, that gives us a lot of freedom to do what we want. And this independence is something that we really value. And it's also something that is characterizing our work in general, but in sustainability in particular. So we have a quite ambitious vision, and that is to become the most sustainable denim brand. And whatever that means then includes one part that cannot really be overseen. And that is transparency and traceability. And that's what I wanted to focus a bit on here today. We are a quite small brand, and a lot of the relationship with the suppliers is built upon personal contact, being able to visit the suppliers, which has been really hard this last year. But previously, we have done a lot of visits and closed, establishing the contact with all of our suppliers, as you can see here in this chart. We have 1% here in tier 4 for the raw material suppliers, but actually we do have, they are representing 10% of the production volume for us. So we do have a close contact with the raw material suppliers and the farming groups that are involved in the cotton production for us. And the topic of transparency has been with us for quite many years now. We launched this one in 2013. It's a production guide where you can see, it's like an interactive map where you can see where we are producing and read more about the suppliers. This one was made up without any technology. Basically, we try to connect our internal systems and try to show this to the consumers. But over the years, we have developed this a bit. So today we are having, or last year actually, we were launching this product level transparency that we have now online, I must say that we're quite happy to accomplish this during last year. I mean, considering the pandemic that we were all in, but this production level transparency is really beneficial for both consumers but also for us internally. So here you see what we have done. We have a structure where we have listed all the steps in the production. The job behind this is quite manual still. But we are looking into different technologies now to see whether we can get better and easier data to it and see how we can connect our systems to show it. But as said, it's really improvement for our internal work as well. And some would say that having this kind of transparency is really the end goal that all companies want to have, to be able to show this full view of your supply chain. But we have always argued that this is the first stepping stone towards more compliance in the supplying countries, but also towards brand accountability. And to actually map what you are doing in the supply chain, to map your climate impact, for example, that we have done for several years, and in all scopes with actual figures, or to work with living wages is a very complex topic in the supply chain, or even to work with substituting materials to be more sustainable. It's all built upon the transparency that we have in our supply chain and that we worked for many years. And I think also traceability and transparency of products will become even more crucial when we move into the circular economy. So yeah, that's what I wanted to introduce you to.
Thank you so much, Sandya. Thank you for being with us online. Great. I do have a couple of questions coming to us from our audience online. And let me just have a look at what we have as the first one. Dear Nicole, I'm a researcher in Berlin producing mycelium leather. What kind of investors can you recommend without giving too much away from a potential company?
So if it's okay, I will give you my email and then we could chat. So anyone, here's my email. It's Nicole, N-I-C-O-L-E-R for Rawling at materialinnovation.org. And we have a director of, a chief innovation officer who works with all of the investors. I think we've got around 200 in our network at the moment who are actively looking for these types of products, and we'll help you with your pitch deck, we'll help you think through your business plan, we'll help you think through your team, and by the way, this is all free, so please reach out.
How amazing is that? So yeah, fingers crossed, and thank you so much for your question. We have another question coming from someone online, and this question is actually for you, Lavinia, and the question is, what do you take into consideration in your risk assessment of new materials? How does that work?
How does that work? Well, again, it's a very complex issue, but it does contain or it indicates social and environmental impact parameters. So first of all, when we talk about the raw material, you know, it starts with the raw material stage. And when we talk about eventually a natural fiber like cotton, which is grown by human beings, obviously certain certifications and certain wage and payment structures have to be secured. No child labor. Big issue. Then organic certification always. We are like an organic company for virgin fibers, not for recycled, because this is another issue. And then the parameters go up the whole supply chain. So each and every production step has certain risks of chemical input and chemical residues on the garment or even in the wastewater streams, as well as certain social indicators. And then it obviously depends on the country of production, because in each and every country of production, there's different risks. So it's a pretty complex Excel file I'm trying to work with and like tell my colleagues, check this, and yeah.
So talking about complexity, here we go again. Thank you. I actually do have a question for all three of you. So you were mentioning circular economy. We were talking a lot about social justice, living wages, completely phasing out animals out of the supply chain. How can we make sure circular economy and reuse and better design is actually directly linked to the social impact as well? What needs to happen? What do we need to do to be able to claim that circular economy is really fully aligned with the social impact as well? Who would like to start? Sandya, how about you?
Yeah, of course. Thank you so much. Yeah, it's a good question and a very relevant question, I would say. From our perspective, we believe that, I mean, having traceable products and transparent production chain will be a key issue even for the social aspects in the supply chain. There's the whole idea of not leaving anyone behind, but at the same time also developing the business and the activities around the circular economy is really crucial. I think we still have a lot to learn here in this field.
Many thanks for sharing your view on this.
Yeah, I can also.
Lavinia, please.
I would love to add something. I think it's also very important what kind and how we are implementing and establishing a circular economy post-pandemic, because there's a lot of talking going on, but actually almost nothing is happening. You know, there's some recycling over there, there's some super nice packaging over there, but actually what fashion brands are doing right now is upscaling their sales. And eventually they're having like a circular or whatever recycled capsule collection, but when we look at the volumes and the production portfolio, it's a big lie. And also like I do believe a benefit of the post-pandemic world could be like more local production also over here when it comes to taking back, sorting, recycling. But the same has to happen in the so-called countries of the global south. Mm. And I think there's a lot of potential that we can actually bring together actions around climate change and waste management. cooperating with NGOs, with recyclers, implementing innovative recycling streams in the countries of production. So then creating jobs and like really, really, really bringing back the value into the supply chain and not into the pockets of the stake and shareholders of the big corporations.
Absolutely loving the vision. Looking at you, Nicole, so you're representing animal welfare here. How does this play into circular economy and social justice?
Well, I'll say we look at this issue in two different ways. I think number one, I say start at home. And by that, I mean like my organization, I'm the CEO. So making sure that we've got great practices internally. We actually are very diverse in the gender. Well, not, we're actually not diverse in the gender side. We only have one man on the team. Our entire board of directors is women. We do have more minority populations. We have a lot of great internal practices to ensure autonomy and fair working wages, which is actually kind of hard in the nonprofit field. But when you look at the entire fashion industry, where I think the benefit is our expertise is not social issues. We have a very narrow expertise, right, which is raw materials made from animal products used in fashion, automotive, and home goods. And that makes us really good experts in what we do. But what we want to do then is partner with other experts in other areas like social justice so that we can incorporate their expertise into our areas and with the innovators we work with. And so one example of how we're doing that is I'm working with a group that's actually funded by H&M out of Bangladesh called BRAC, B-R-A-C, and they're doing a big conference in the fall that I think I'm going to go speak at as well, that is figuring out how can we all work together to ensure that we are, when we offshore, when we take nearshore everything back to Europe or the United States and out of the global south, how do we ensure job transition? And maybe there's some way that we can also help these people transition to new jobs by giving them business opportunities. That's what we do, is give people business business ideas. Maybe we can help establish some of these businesses in Bangladesh. So to me, it's also that partnership.
Fantastic. I'm hearing quite a lot of collaboration. I'm hearing partnerships, doing it together. So obviously, in order to change sustainable fashion, no one can do it on their own. What do you think? What is the next one single thing all those brands that are considering becoming more sustainable should take as their very first step? Again, question to all of you. Lavinia, looking at you, would you like to kick start it?
There's so many things, because I do believe like when it comes to sustainability, like I'm really bad at prioritizing, because who am I, you know, to prioritize if like gender-based violence is more important than child labor or chemical residues on the final garment or this and that. But I do believe when we talk about the circular economy, it really is overproduction and the waste generated in the supply chain. You know, it's not a nice marketing story, but we really have to tackle this problem, because this will definitely reduce the environmental impact, especially carbon emissions, a lot for each and everyone.
Thanks. So it's really how we can minimize the waste in the overall production.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
How do you look at it, Nicole?
I agree with your statement that it's so hard. And that, sustainability is complicated. Like, there really is no one answer. And if you remember the chart that I put up that had all of the comparisons of the different materials, you know, from water use to abiotic resource depletion, greenhouse gas emissions. Even when, if you look at just environmental factors, what's the most important? I don't know that answer. Brands do choose different things. One cares more about water, one cares about greenhouse gases. So if you can't even prioritize within environmental factors, how do you then also consider human rights issues, consider animal welfare issues?
Or other ethical practices.
Yeah. Do you focus on raw materials? Do you focus on transparency? Do you focus on, you know, certifications or end of life? There's a lot of things. My recommendation is try not to get paralyzed by everything that needs to be done. Pick whatever you do is better than nothing. And I think probably if you do not have a sustainability head or resources put into a sustainability department, that's probably the best thing. And have that person come in and start to work with that brand community to figure out what the highest values are and what's realistic to do within your internal political environment.
So in terms of collaboration, just get help. Ask someone who already has experience with that, and maybe they can help you to evaluate through assessment, like what might be the right step, the most efficient for you, that feels also right for your story to start with. Sandya, over to you. What is your take here?
Yeah, I agree with what you said there before. I mean, it's a very complex situation, and brands do have to choose somewhere to start, I guess. But I think also if you go for like either the social side or the environmental side, you also realize it's connected together. It's very obvious if you look at the sustainable development goals, for example. So I think it's important that that brands actually have the courage and also the energy and possibility to work on all sides simultaneously, because I think it's only then that's going to be real improvement in the end, because otherwise you might be really good at recycling but you don't have any, for example, living wages in your supply chain, or you have a lot of non-compliances at your suppliers, for example. So it all goes hand in hand. And I think brands need to work with both sides of all sides of sustainability, really.
Many thanks for sharing this view with us. Having a look around in the room with our beautiful participants, anyone has a question, that's the opportunity to raise your hand. All right. Please, can you tell us your name and what is your question?
Hello, my name is Maike, and I have a question to you, Lavinia, because you said in the beginning that the cutting waste material is also a big issue and that you are recollecting it to recycle it. But a question that came up to my mind, is there also a way of like reducing the cutting waste and even maybe go zero waste? And how possible or how realistic is it actually for a brand to go zero waste or almost zero waste, let's say?
Yeah, very good question. obviously, first, like before collecting any kind of waste or trash, you should definitely implement certain systematics to actually, first of all, reduce the amount of trash. And obviously, with the pattern makers at our producers, we already did that. Like when we talk about Jersey, for example, the average cutting waste is approximately 12%. We were able to reduce it to 7 or 8%. On the other hand, we also have to realize if we do not use 3D printers, there will always be some waste. So anybody who's telling you no waste, this is bullshit. And then I wanted to add something. Zero waste production, right? If this is possible. I think it should be the end goal. But we first of all have to make clear what we define as waste, you know. And as I said in the beginning, like when I talk about waste or waste streams, it's not only like the cutting waste or like from the main material, you know. Mm-hmm. For me, waste is also the chemical residues in the water, the toxic pesticides which go down into the groundwater on the cotton fields. It's also the energy we are using if this is not regenerated and like not coming from renewable sources. We are anyways creating waste. So I think zero waste production or zero waste streams is the end goal. We will never reach it to 100%, but I think we can do a lot in this journey. Yeah.
Thank
you
so much.
For the better of the planet.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can I mention one company that...
Go ahead, Nicole.
So there is a company called Natural Fiber Welding that makes a leather, and they require all the cutting to happen in their facility, and all of the scraps are 100% recycled back into their facility because they can actually, the way their technology works, allows it all to go back in. And then we are actually working with a lot of 3D printed companies.
Awesome.
And then another cool technology that might solve this issue is the mycelium-based leathers. You can spray it. So you can actually take a mold and spray the material onto the mold. And so there's no cutting.
What a wonderful add-on.
Yeah.
Trying to be mindful of time, hence I'd like to kindly ask you to keep it as one sentence. We're talking about this next-gen materials. It's becoming very clear that the materials that we were so used to in the past are not a viable option going towards a sustainable future. In your view, and that's again a question to all three of you, what is the material we should be using more going forward? Just one thing. What is it for you, Nicole?
Does it have to be on the market right now?
No, doesn't have to be.
Then I would say probably next-gen silk.
Next-gen silk, thank you. Lavinia?
For me, it's definitely biosynthetic, and I do believe in, how do you call this in English, fungus? Yeah, I'm a big fan of fungus, like eating, wearing, whatever. I do believe this is going to save us.
Great,
and our resources,
you.
Yeah.
Many thanks. Sandya, what is it for you?
I think we will just expand our reuse section and then also our take-back system. So what we already do today, but the scaling it up, basically, and using our own material, old jeans, in our new production.
Super. Thank you so much. And hereby, I just want to conclude that we had an amazing opportunity to hear from Lavinia Muth from Armedangels. We had Nicole Rawling from Material Innovation Institute, and we got a chance to hear also from Sandya Lang from Nudie Jeans. Thank you, ladies, very much. And everyone, be sustainable, be awesome. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.